Vediamo un attimo. Secondo me è avviata la registrazione? Sì, adesso. Ok. Ok. Questa è la seconda parte della lezione di 2 dicembre. Abbiamo iniziato la registrazione, ma temo che quello che si vedrà è questo piccolo quadratino. Non possiamo farlo come in Meet, dove si vedeva la lavagna. Tra l'altro, voi vedete la lavagna? Se adesso vado verso la lavagna, penso potete vederla.
Sì, però vediamo un po' sfocata la scritta.
Allora, possiamo vedere solo la qualità, come mi sembra che la qualità debba essere pessima. No,
Per me è buona, però
è
non.
buona. Anche per me non è così male.
Ah, l'unico problema, come vedete sul mio schermo, è che quando inizio la registrazione sarà questo angolino. Io non posso farla come nell'altro di essere, ho fatto pin and pin, ma non funziona, non posso farlo. Ecco, quando abbiamo tutte le persone, io che cosa posso fare? Exit spotlight. Oppure posso fare in evidenza. Non posso praticamente vedere lo schermo intero,
Professore,
anzi,
non ho capito. Lei non si vede a schermo intero?
sì, quello è il problema. Qualcun
Perché.
altro deve registrarmi perché io da qui vedo come quando abbiamo condiviso lo schermo, avete visto, vedo un angolino piccolo piccolo. Mi sono messo lì. E non posso farmi proprio, e siccome abbiamo fatto registrazione l'altra volta, quello è un piccolo quadratino e tutti voi sullo schermo intero. Non posso farlo come in Meet. E non so come si può exit spotlight, modalità, collabora, anteprima, griglia, schermo.
Professore, si deve mettere in evidenza.
Come?
Dovrebbe essere possibile fissare uno dei video sullo schermo.
Come?
Sì, cioè, per esempio, ho cliccato su, appunto, sul schermo dove c'era la lavagna e la vedo a schermo intero adesso. Quindi non so se magari anche lei prova a premere.
Ecco, io preso schermo intero. E di nuovo sono nell'angolino sotto. Quando vado sulla Exit Spotlight, c'è Spotlight. E poi non posso, prima cliccando su il mio quadratino piccolo, diventava più grande. Ecco, per esempio, io posso vedere intero ognuno di voi, ma io non posso mettere me sullo schermo intero me stesso. Quello è il problema. Posso seguire solo gli altri separatamente oppure seguire una persona concreta sull'intero schermo e posso registrare questo. Questo significa che se qualcuno di voi registra la presentazione, questo può essere fatto, ma poi abbiamo provato questo con gli studenti. Durante la registrazione si interrompe da solo. Quindi passiamo a whiteboard, quello che usavo prima della pausa, visto che questi problemi non si possono risolvere facilmente. Se qualcuno di voi può mettere se stesso nell'intero schermo, mi fa sapere come lo fa. Io non posso mettermi sull'intero schermo perché la registrazione è quello che io vedo nel cioè abbiamo fatto registrazioni, potete vedere che adesso siamo già 8 minuti di registrazione, facciamo, è risultato un piccolo quadratino. Ok, I have the proposal to switch to whiteboard that we used before the break. If you agree, we can do this. Okay. Vedo altri. Ma che cosa è questo? Modalità. Successo una cosa stranissima. Applica effetti sfondo, disattiva. Allora, condividiamo lo schermo. Finestra, ok, condividiamo. Can you see the screen?
Sì.
My screen?
Yes.
Sì.
Ok. Somebody has some technical problems. Can you see everybody?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Therefore, we can go further with our calculation of the covariance. So, we had the covariance. And after this, we can turn back to our. Can you see now the screen?
Vediamo. Vediamo lei, però diciamo.
Ma... Che cosa mi hanno fatto? Questo è un attimo, questo è modalità collabora. Qual è questo trucco? Anteprima, grilla schermo. Ok, lasciamo perdere, non posso fare nulla, qualcosa è successo per il momento. Andiamo avanti con nostra, torniamo al nostro corso. E la registrazione mi sembra iniziata. Se ad un certo punto, perché avevamo questi problemi, si ferma la registrazione, fatemelo sapere per riprendere la registrazione. Ok. A questo punto noi abbiamo trovato, we have found the covariance formula for two random variables, and we said covariance is the measurement of independence of these two random variables. But we have to go further and try to see another important property of the covariance, and especially of the property connected with the variance of the sum of two. Our next step is to study the variance of sum of two random variables, assuming x and y are independent. Independent. Let me first of all recall you the definition of the variance. Do you remember the definition of the variance? For example, if I want to say variance of x, what is this? If we have only one random variable, what was the definition? If you have forgotten, we know that variance of x is the covariance with x equal to y. So this is covariance of xx when you take the same. And according to this generic formula, this shall be the expectation of x squared minus expectation of x to the power 2. Okay, so this is to remind you the definition of the variance. And of course, from this, we can simply say that if you, for example, take here a constant C and multiply your x by C, since here multiplying x by C, when you put here C, put here C, you replace x by constant times x, here you shall have C squared. And of course, in the expectation, any constant can be taken outside. So our constant shall go outside C squared. And also from here, the constant will go outside, but due to this square, we shall have C squared. So the important property is that the constant of the random variable goes out like C squared, the variance of x. So when you multiply your random variable by constant, it goes out like x, like C squared. We shall see another important property, that variance of x plus y shall be sum of two variances. But let us first make the calculations and then to have the conclusion, what is the variance of x and y when we have independent random variables. So we apply the formula. This is our formula one. And with the help of this formula, we compute the variance of x plus y. Of course, due to, if you don't mind, I shall clean now the red one. And we shall forget about this constant C. We have simply the expectation of x squared minus expectation of x to the power 2. You see the difference here. First we take x squared and then the expectation, and here first expectation and then the square. So we do the same thing. Here expectation of x plus y squared. This is this guy minus, and now I have to take expectation of x plus y, all this squared. Here we applied the relation one. And of course, here we can take the squares. So this is expectation of what? Of x squared plus 2 times x epsilon. I take the square plus epsilon squared minus. When you compute the expectation of the sum, we know that additive property of the expectation can be applied, and we have that this expectation of sum, if sum is sum of two expectations, expectation x plus expectation of epsilon, all this to the power 2. And now we have to make again the fact that the expectation of a sum is sum of expectations. So this shall become due to the simple properties of expectation. This is expectation of x squared plus x two times. We said that expectation 2 goes outside the expectation with the same constant. We have expectation of x epsilon plus expectation of epsilon squared. And then I have to subtract minus a of x. Now I expand this square. Here we have two real numbers, a and b. And I am writing the square of these two real numbers. We have first ax to the power 2 minus 2 times a of x times a of epsilon and then minus the expectation of epsilon. All this after the expectation is squared. And we are almost done, because remember that till the moment we never use the fact that x and y are independent variables. When they are independent variables, remember what was our example? One. Showing that expectation of x epsilon is expectation of x times expectation of epsilon. Therefore, I am using this property of example 1 and turn back to my calculation. And immediately I can discover that these two guys, they cancel because their difference is 0 due to my example 1. Further, we can notice that our definition of the variance, definition 1, says that a of x squared minus a of x, all this squared, this is the variance of x. So this is the variance of x. And in the same way, I take the blue one, and say that this is the variance of epsilon. And I have to take the sum of these two guys. From time to time, we have this strange property, appearance of some symbols that I always have difficult to clean because now disappeared. Okay. If this whiteboard I don't like very much, but never mind. This is variance of epsilon. So, what is the conclusion? Thanks to my assumption that x and y are independent, we cancel this guy. And we saw that variance of x plus y is variance of x plus variance of y. So we can turn to our property and say that here we have important assertion, lemma. That's saying, when x and y are independent, the variance of x plus y is the variance of x plus the variance of epsilon. And this property we shall use essentially when we study so-called rules of laws of the great numbers. Therefore, this is so-called central limiting theorem type assertions. But this we shall do later on. The important thing today is to introduce variance, covariance, and see that when we have independent random variables, variance satisfies this additive property. Okay, let me stop for the moment and ask you if you have some questions connected with the proof of this lemma, because here in four lines we presented the proof that variance of x plus y is variance of x plus variance of y when they are independent, when x and y are independent random variables. For this, I am waiting for some of your remarks, questions before going further. Yes, if you have some remarks. Okay. Actually, here we have to say something at the end. Why we introduced this expectation, variation, this is very important because we shall see that if we assume that, for example, let us assume that expectation of my random variable x is computed. This is some constant. Actually, to compute this, remember, expectation was when we take our probability density p of x, we have to put in front x, take here the x, and integrating, this was our expectation. Now, our problem is to see the link, connection between probability that, for example, our x random variable is bigger or equal than some fixed number a, and the expectation of x. We should expect that when the expectation is bounded, and for example, if we take our interval e to be, for example, OR. Intuitively, we know that if our random variable and the event is that our random variable is bigger than A, when A is big and this is bounded, we expect that A big, if you prefer, you can say going to infinity, then probably probability that x is bigger than a shall be small. For example, if we have model of listening, we have to listen some range of frequencies. If this range of frequencies is from 0 to plus infinity, of course, what we can listen should be very high frequencies, but in any case, our possibilities to hear these frequencies is limited. Therefore, when we have higher and higher frequencies, we cannot hear. Cannot hear something that is with very high frequency. Intuitively, this is obvious, but if we have its probability interpretation, then we can say that we need more precise connection between big A and probability that X is bigger than A shall be small. What does it mean? And the answer for this intuitive assertion is the following inequality that is very important inequality. Let me write you first in very simple way. First of all, to remind you, what is the precise definition? Probability X is bigger than or equal than A. This we have written before, but we shall write again. For the case where the interval is, for example, we can take minus infinity plus infinity. In this case, we said that probability that X is bigger than A, usually we took integration of all interval of our probability density dx. But instead of taking integral over all x, this inequality says that our domain is x bigger than a. Or here I have to take, sorry, this is a. So I have to take integral from a to plus infinity of px dx. In alternative way, so this is practically the definition. In alternative way, I can introduce so-called characteristic function of a set A. How is defined this function when we have any subset A is subset our interval? How is defined the characteristic set of this interval, of this set A? So characteristic function means that it has value 1 when x belongs to A, and 0 other. This is very important function because enables us to simplify our definitions. And of course, here we can represent with the help of this function our integral as integral over the whole set. But here we take the characteristic function of the set X bigger than A times PX dx. So this is characteristic function in the point X. So what is the meaning of this characteristic function? Simply, when x is bigger or equal than a, this is 1. When x is smaller than a, this is 0. Therefore, this is another way of writing this integral because we have taken specific interval e. But you know, we can have different choices of our probability interval. For example, in the case of musical pieces, we have a very precise interval of frequencies, and typical all sonatas, all songs, they are written with inside this range. Therefore, when E is different interval, we can simply keep this formula that shows that our probably, let me write a little bit better this formula. So we have characteristic function of the set x bigger or equal than a at the point x, as it is defined here, then we multiply this by probability density px and integrate in dx. In this sense, we want to show that when a is big enough, this probability density is very small. And this is really true. I shall write only the assertion more precisely, and we shall continue the next time to show this property. This is important lemma that has a very simple proof, but I prefer not now to put all possible arguments. This lemma, typically these facts were developed by Russian schools, therefore the name in this case is Markov lemma. Now I have to clean this guy, and I have the same problem as before. Now I succeeded rapidly. And what we have is the following. When you take probability that your random variable is bigger than or equal than A, this actually shall be smaller or equal than the expectation of our random variable, that is fixed number, divided by A. Therefore, here you can see exactly mathematical expression, rigorous mathematical expression of what we said. Bigger A is, smaller probability of our random variable we have. And this depends how big is the expectation, but this is fixed number. So when we choose different A, we see that big A, this quantity goes to zero when A goes to plus infinity. And this is the famous Markov inequality. The proof is one line, but as I said, I prefer not to have too heavy lectures. We have practically to prove this inequality the last time, the next time, the next week, and see the law of big numbers, therefore to see what will happen thanks to this inequality. And another inequality that takes the name of Chebyshev, so we shall speak about Chebyshev. That connects, Chebyshev connects this type of probability with the variance and explains why expectation and variance, they are in the important characterization of our random variables. And therefore, this shall be our purpose together with the fact that thanks to these two properties connecting probability with expectation and the variance, we shall try to see that really when you take many random variables, xn, in some sense their mean value over n, when you take the distance to the expectation, we said that the expectation of x is mu. If we assume that all these random variables have the same expectation mu, and when we take the arithmetic mean, subtract the expectation, then in some sense this property to be bigger than a fixed number epsilon is practically with probability very small. Probability of all this event, if we take the probability of this guy, is something that is very small when n goes to infinity. This means more independent variables, for example, more dice you use, when you take the mean value, if you have the same mean value of this, the same expectation of all random variables, then practically you are very, very close to your expectation. But this we shall do without moving in a hurry the next week. For the moment, I leave a small space for your questions. I think the essential part we did is Markov, state the Markov inequality. All this after Markov statement is the plan for the next week. But what we did today, the important thing was this property of the variance, additive property, when we have two independent variables, and the definitions of variance, covariance, and then we had the definition of independent random variables. This is more or less the essential part of our appointment today. So I leave a little bit space for your questions.
Professore, soltanto una cosa, martedì prossimo non abbiamo lezione, giusto? Perché è l'8 di dicembre, è festa.
Va bene se non ci sono lezioni, no, in ogni caso io penso che il corso è 56 ore, io non so come possiamo arrivare a 56. Forse hanno preso in considerazione il fatto che possiamo avere ricevimenti per preparare l'orale? Una specie di... perché corso è 56 ore, noi abbiamo fatto fino a questo momento tutto e se con le feste arriviamo, penso, massimo 48 ore, non so come arriviamo a 56. Forse dobbiamo aggiungere qualcosa. Sono d'accordo per il prossimo martedì, ma poi eventualmente dobbiamo avere qualche giorno in cui io metto come orario di ricevimento per la preparazione e possiamo dedicare un po' di tempo, perché mi sembra la parte pratica manca. A voi serve aiuto, poi se non serve nessun problema, io posso anche non fare nulla, ma io sono disponibile entro 56 ore, anche un po' di più, di lavorare. Poi decidete voi se è
professore,
possibile.
Ma comunque sì? Quindi potremmo fare delle esercitazioni in quelle ore lì aggiuntive che diceva
certo, e chi vuole. Certo, soprattutto ecco come si è visto oggi un po' di cose concrete, pratiche, perché così si prepara meglio anche l'orale, perché abbiamo detto non c'è un scritto ufficiale, ma in ogni caso qualche esempio, qualche esercizietto dobbiamo fare. Mi sembra ottima idea, se per voi è una cosa utilissima, io in ogni caso offro questi ore aggiuntivi con esercizi. Finiamo la parte teorica praticamente con legge di grandi numeri, io penso che avremo praticamente quasi tutto, poi di nuovo si torna alla statistica, un po' di verifica di ipotesi, ma queste sono cose un po' più pratiche, più semplici. Invece la parte pesante della probabilità mi sembra con legge di grandi numeri è ok. Pensiamoci, per il momento il nostro prossimo appuntamento, se ho capito bene, è prossimo mercoledì.
Sì, il 9.
Va benissimo, così perfetto, grazie per questo aggiornamento. E qualche altra domanda? Se non ci sono altre domande, io per un attimo fermo la condivisione. Allora, anche buone feste, vi auguro buona festa la prossima settimana e poi con calma mercoledì ci vediamo di nuovo. Grazie per l'attenzione e alla prossima.
Grazie
a te.
Arrivederci.